having a good time and waiting for the session that we have been through one day, and we almost done already for Thailand Focus 2013. Welcome back to the final session of Thailand Focus 2013. The panel discussion would be the property in Myanmar, whether boom, bust, or both. Our panelists are Mr. Tony Picon, Managing Director from Colliers International Myanmar, Mr. Cyrus Pan, Executive Director and Head of Real Estate Division from Yoma Strategic Holding Limited. And the moderator is Mr. Lee Miller, Editor-at-Large, Bloomberg News. Please welcome our panelist and moderator on the stage. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Welcome to the closing session of Thailand Focus 2013. I'd like to congratulate and thank the SET for organizing and staging this event. I'm sure from the set perspective, there was probably no specific plan to schedule it during such a volatile time in the regional and global markets. But there certainly has been a lot of drama in the stock, currency, bond, and global politics during the past week or so. I've been reporting from the region for Bloomberg News since 1991. That's long enough to remember when ASEAN was just six countries: Thailand, Indonesia, Singapore, Malaysia, Brunei, and the Philippines. There have been a lot of meetings over time, economic, business, political. Sometimes China's invited, sometimes Japan, sometimes Korea or Australia or the US. During the past two decades, though, much of the emerging market focus has been outside of ASEAN, on the BRICS. At today's events, we've been learning and hearing about the CLMV grouping, another acronym we're all supposed to remember: Cambodia, Laos, Myanmar, and Vietnam, all the newest members of ASEAN. Frankly, ASEAN is easy to pronounce. BRICS is easy to pronounce. I'm not sure how CLMV is supposed to be pronounced. The final panel topic is, as was mentioned earlier, property in Myanmar, boom, bust, or both. Regardless of whether the answer is optimistic or pessimistic, the storyline is somewhat surprising. It's often been said that until about 50 years ago, Myanmar, Burma at the time, was the richest country in Southeast Asia. But for the vast majority of people, the past five decades has been a stagnant economy, while other economies in the region, the neighbors, suddenly opened their doors to development. While change is never sudden, Myanmar's shift in political direction and economic ambitions was nonetheless very swift. Things changed virtually overnight 2 years ago, setting the stage for true economic development and integration potential. And so that's why the fact we're having a discussion on opportunities for investors in Myanmar's property market at an event organized by the Stock Exchange of Thailand is so intriguing and so impressive. It's a symbol that Myanmar is no longer isolated, and it is full of opportunity and risk, just like everywhere else in ASEAN. To teach us more about Myanmar's property and investment climate, we have two very able experts: Mr. Cyrus Pan, Executive Director and Head of Real Estate Division of Yoma Strategic Holdings, and Mr. Tony Picon, Managing Director of Colliers International Myanmar. Yoma Strategic is a publicly traded company in Singapore with focus on designing, developing, building, and managing real estate projects in Myanmar and, to a lesser degree, in China. It's the only publicly traded proxy for investment in Myanmar, and the company's founder and chairman, Sergey Pung, is pioneer in the remodernization of Myanmar's economy. His son, Cyrus, is a graduate of the London School of Economics and Political Science and has officially been head of Yoma for almost 3 years. He's been a leading part of another of the SPA group since 2007. If you want to do real estate investment in Myanmar now, You will either have to go through Cyrus, work with him, or become a direct competitor. Tony Picon is a familiar face in Thailand as well as Myanmar, as he's worked here for about 3 years, or he lived here for about 3 years. And then a year and a half ago, he's been going back and forth to Myanmar and living there for Colliers International. One added benefit of having Tony on the panel is he also worked for a time in Vietnam. So we'll be able to give us some perspectives there as well. He's a graduate of University of Newcastle in the UK, which is quite a contrast to where he's been the past couple decades. So I've asked Tony, who authored and continues to author the first international property reports on Myanmar and Laos, to make a presentation on the current situation to give us an overview, and afterwards we'll have a conversation. So, Tony.
Thank you very much. Do the presentation? Just one thing to help Lee out with the acronyms. If you exclude Vietnam, I use the word the calm countries, which is Cambodia, Laos, and Myanmar, which are more appropriate in a Thailand concept, because these are the countries where a lot of sub-regional offices will probably be set up to service those countries. So calm sounds a lot easier to remember, for me anyway. So. As I say, I've been living in Yangon for a year and a half, and I've been coming back and forth to Yangon for about 2.5 years, and I've noticed some amazing changes even since I've been there. I'm just going to give you a very brief overview, because the main idea is going to be a panel discussion, so just to give you a little bit of feeling if you haven't been there, or it's all very new for some of you, I think. We've zoned the city by grouping townships together, which makes it a little bit easier for us in terms of research. We've only got three zones because there is such limited supply of the real estate that we cover, which is mass retail, office service apartments, and 4 or 5 star hotels. So over time, when we start to see the development of real estate as we've seen in other countries, these zones will start to break up into smaller areas, and new areas will be included. But at the moment, because there's such a limited supply, if we started to have more zones, there'll be a lot of zeros on a lot of graphs. We've based it on a very simple idea that downtown is the traditional CBD of the city. It's where the city began under colonial times, where the trading houses exist. The Little India is there, Chinatown, all the trading houses, the shipping companies, and it's still very vibrant and still very reminiscent of other Southeast Asian countries 50 years ago. It's like a living history of other countries. And is now also likely to continue to be the CBD, even though it may shift a little bit within the area, it will continue to be the main CBD for probably some time. The inner city is predominantly the wealthy, most of the wealthy people live in the inner city. It's a lot of the embassies are there, a lot of the tourist attractions, especially Shwedagon Pagoda is located there. And you'll see a lot of the higher end retail malls located in this area. At the moment, outer city is everything else, so it doesn't really have a personality. We've included Tan Lin at the bottom, which is just outside of Yangon, to accommodate Yoma Strategic Holdings, who have a development there. So we created a zone just for them, added the zones. But as I say, that will change over the next sort of 5 to 10 years. We'll start to rezone the city. I'm just going to give you a very brief overview of each sector. For people from Singapore, the good or bad news is the rentals have reached above Singapore levels. And even to distort the market a little bit more, that's for grade A in Singapore, and you wouldn't really say that Myanmar office grade A is grade A by Singaporean standards. So you're getting probably a grade C building in Singapore for your $75 or $78. There is a lack of supply. The overall supply in Yangon is around 60,000 square meters, which, you know, is smaller than single office buildings in many countries, and there's quite a few in Thailand that are bigger. There's going to be over 100% increase in supply in the next 2 or 3 years. That sounds great, but it's still only 60,000 square meters. So we see a chronic undersupply in the next few years. When we look at where the demand is going to come from over that course of that period, which I think will can be discussed in the panel discussion. The retail sector is a different sector in a sense. The office sector is more FDI based. The retail sector is a very local, local developers catering to a local end user. That's changing a little bit now as we're seeing more foreigners come to the city, but most retail outlets are predominantly Myanmar people shopping. And the inner city area is the main area because that's where the more of the wealthy live. Majority of Myanmar people or Yangon people do not have the income to spend a significant amount of their money in mass retail. So it's still your cheap mum and pop stores that predominate in Myanmar. The hotel sector, the key to the hotel sector is the rates have risen, as anyone who's been to Yangon 2 or 3 years ago can attest to. Two or three years ago, backpackers could stay in business, 4 or 5 star hotels. Now business people are having to stay in backpacker hotels. So the rates have been rising enormously, especially since the Hillary Clinton visit, which was the game changer for Myanmar, the Nixon in China moment for the country. And so rates have gone up, but the downside is that occupancy has gone down. A lot of people are now, business people who regularly travel to Yangon, which is a considerable number, after their first few visits start to downgrade their hotels and they'll stay in your locally owned $100 a night hotels because it's just too costly to keep staying in other hotels at $300. So there is a flip side to this, that in some senses, at the moment, there's an oversupply, especially during the rainy season. Service apartment market, I think, is more serious because when you see investment coming into the country, that means expats coming in at a managerial level, on a technical level, and they want to stay somewhere, and often they want to stay somewhere nice, and there is a chronic undersupply of service apartments in the city. Again, we're going to see growth, but not enough to cater for demand. Most of my friends, including myself, live in local apartments without a swimming pool, without your facilities, with a lift that barely works. And that's the lifestyle that a lot of people have decided to take on if they want to be in Myanmar. The other thing that exacerbates the problem is there's a lack of apartments for lease and also of good quality condos that can be rented out. So in all those aspects, I'm more concerned about the lack of service apartments than the lack of quality hotel buildings. I think that's going to be the big crunch that's going to cause problems for investment. Condominium sector is growing rapidly. This is a very local market, local developers selling predominantly to local buyers because there is no law allowing foreign ownership at the moment, although we're expecting very soon some form of condominium law that will allow, firstly, a legal status for condominiums, because at the moment the definition of a condo is that it has a lift, and that's it. And even if the lift doesn't work, it still classes a condominium. So it's not the condo how you imagine in Bangkok or Singapore or elsewhere. So, there is an increase in supply and launches, I think probably too much. A lot of developers are taking on too many units, developing too many units, so we could have a problem of delivery of those condos. But it's still a very vibrant business because that's where Myanmar people put their cash. They put it into land and they put it into condo units. Industrial sector, this is just some idea of the prices. There is a pretty wide range in prices depending on the industrial state. It doesn't suffer from demand and supply. It suffers from owners or permit holders sitting on the land and not wanting to do anything with it and then believing they can command an extremely high price for it and foreigners walking away. And that's where we are at the moment with the industrial sector. But that's set to change, hopefully, when Tilawa SEZ is launched, but we're still waiting for that to happen. And just to say that Colliers, we're involved in Myanmar, we do research reports, and we've just set up an office in the best office building in Yangon called Centerpoint. We opened up last month, so that's my little talk.
Okay, that's a perfect introduction because it gave us a little overview of every segment, at least from one standpoint. So Cyrus, you obviously your family has the roots there, and you can, as I don't think I was exaggerating when I was saying that if somebody wants to go business in Myanmar some way, somehow they're going to touch the SPA group or compete directly with you. So give us an overview of what, are the main things that you're working on, number one? And maybe the second thing is what keeps you up at night?
That's, sorry about this technical hitch.
Yeah, it's on now.
If I can just give you a very broad background of what we do as a company, so to set the backdrop for to answer your questions. We've been in Myanmar doing business for the last 20 years. Right? The very first project that we did was in real estate. Right? Now our group has quite a diverse interest in various sectors. Including agriculture, including banking, automobile distribution, some services, and so on. But real estate still remains our biggest business within the group. So right now we are developing three projects at this moment in time, three ongoing projects. Some of them stem from quite a way back when we started to move into Myanmar with acquired land banks that we're still developing. Some of them are newly acquired land, but essentially most of the existing projects that we're doing now are residential. We're about to move on to a mixed-use development project in the center of Yangon. I think this is the most opportune time in Yangon, in Myanmar right now, where we have quite clearly an intense interest from the investment community from abroad. A lot of developers wanting to go into Myanmar to set up, a lot of investors wanting to put their money into Myanmar and gain some exposure there. Right? Our company is listed on the Singapore Stock Exchange since 2006, so we have an advantage of being seen as a foreign company. In the eyes of the foreign investors, we have a Singapore company, a listed company. We've done projects abroad in China, in Hong Kong, as well as in Thailand. At the same time, in Myanmar, we're seen as a local company. So in many ways, the certain restrictions that foreign companies faces in Myanmar, we are not prohibited by that. So we get the benefits of being able to be the bridge between foreign capital and local opportunities in Myanmar. That is what we are now trying most to capitalize on. In Tony's presentation, it's seen quite clearly that the real takeaway from that presentation is that there's an acute shortage of supply in Myanmar right now across all sectors, be it residential, be it offices, be it hotels and service apartment. To put it into perspective, residential units that came onto supply in the last 10 years amount to a total of probably less than 1,500 units over the period of 10 years or so. And yet, it's a city of 3 to 4 million people. So you can see proportionately, the stock currently is very low. Right? The demand is there. We're just seeing the uptake of demand now. In our real estate project, we see that sales of apartment units are growing faster, and we're selling faster and faster as time moves on, and people become more and more confident about the economic progress of the country. So this is the perfect time for us to focus on a few things. One is to consolidate the existing business that we have, to make sure that our existing projects are done to a high quality that meets the current demand. At the same time, I think Myanmar, we very much see Myanmar as a long-term play. Okay? Obviously, that is because we're based in Myanmar, we are essentially a Myanmar company with roots in Myanmar, so that's where our core competence and competitive advantage really is. So in some ways, we're stuck in Myanmar anyway, be it good or bad. But in many ways, I also see that as of now, we're only seeing the beginning of all this process. A lot of people have talked about, and the title of this panel is also, is it boom or bust? Right? To me, I think we're seeing just the tip of the iceberg of what is to come. Right? So from my point of view as managing the real estate division of my company, I think we take a much longer term perspective. In doing so, we need to take a strategic approach where we can acquire land and projects at the right price so that we sustain that capacity for growth in the years to come. We're also diversifying a little bit into other types of assets, being the new mixed-use development project in Yangon City Center, where we're not selling, we're just renting. So that's a long-term asset that we hold and lease out to enable us to get a steady income as well as to be exposed to the capital growth in the future.
So in terms of residential, who's your market?
Well, right now, if you look at the buyers in the market right now, many of them are wealthy individuals, wealthy families. Some are old money, some are foreign money coming back to the country. So local businessmen with foreign roots and foreign capital. Local businesses, old family money that has been stashed for a long time and now starting to service. We see a lot of, well, in 2010, the change was very remarkable, in fact. Before 2010, we sold probably, in two of our projects together, we sold less than 10 units of houses a year. Right? The market was very quiet. There's no loan, there's no mortgages in the market. Everyone buys on cash only. Today, they still do that. Right? So when people come and buy, they bring a whole stash of cash because, bear in mind, the highest denomination of the local currency is 10,000 chats, which is about 10 US dollars. And most people do not have bank accounts, and they everything is paid on cash, so they carry a big stash of cash. In 2010, we see that, whereas before it was very quiet, all of a sudden, people started rushing to buy land, to buy properties. At that time, I would say that it's mainly from the hope of speculation. So there's a huge speculation element to it. But the point that you need to bear in mind is that all of that is fully cash funded. All of those purchases were from private wealth that they have accumulated over the years. And whereas in the past, there have been the Myanmar people, because of capital restrictions and so on, they've only been able to invest in, and most people only invest in, US dollars or gold. After 2008, of course, gold prices started shooting up. US dollars, there was a lot of negative sentiment on the US dollars, so gold and US dollars became a lot less attractive. At the same time, with the new reform processes in Myanmar, the new government coming in, there was a very overwhelmingly optimistic sentiment in the economy. So people started to put their money in real estate, firstly in the city center areas and gradually moving out to the outskirts when after the city center land became in some ways overvalued in many areas. So still as of today, to answer your question, most of the buyers are still private wealth people. We are, of course, looking at the possibility that banks will start providing mortgages in the near future. At this point in time, it's still restricted. Not legally restricted as such, but just the banking sector does not have that sort of capacity. And there are certain restrictions to the tenure of loans that banks can give out. So the mortgage market is very, well, is non-existent in Myanmar right now. So when that comes online, I think we'll see a lot more of the middle class, middle income, salary earners, professionals starting to be able to afford these new apartments now.
So that's a different market than you're looking at, you know, to a great extent. When you talk about the serviced apartments, you talk about the commercial, except for maybe the to some extent you mentioned the retail, but and the hotels. So what is the, you know, what is your priority, or what should the investment priority from the foreign perspective be?
Well, okay, at the moment, because we don't have a condominium law, it makes it very difficult for investors to actually put money into a condominium development. I mean, we don't have a BOT structure like you have in Vietnam that allowed a lot of high-end products to go up before the bust in Vietnam. I hope that it will change. There's a condominium law in the works. We've been hearing this you hear a lot of things about laws in the works, and you expect it any moment, and then finally you see a kid on the street selling you the law That's where you find out about the laws of Myanmar, as the kids sell them on the streets. And eventually there will be a condominium law, and it will allow some form of foreign ownership, and hopefully it will allow some form of foreign involvement in terms of investment. The hotel sector, the predominantly hotel service apartment office is focused on FDI. It's rental income. It will not be a condo structure at the moment, again, unless there's a change in the law. So it's a different trajectory. It's also the end users, mostly foreign as well. So the condo market, even before 2010, there was still activity, and the retail market, because it was a local to local market. It was for local buyers who started to make money on jade and other sources of income. Now we're seeing, of course, more foreigners come in, a surge in foreigners looking for office space, for service apartments and for hotels. So that's where the focus is, on catering for these people. And that's going to be something, the demand for those three sectors is going to keep on rising as we get these new surges in demand coming from different sources.
And if you're, okay, so keep in mind our audience for the moment, which has different diverse needs. If you're a FDI investor, a developer of some point, and you're from whether it's Singapore or Japan or Thailand, where do they go? I mean, what could be of the greatest need at the outset? I mean, we saw that commercial spaces, you know, New York or Singapore price, hotels are so expensive that people are taking, you know, guest houses or whatever. So where does a Capital Land or a Keppel or a Mitsubishi or one of Charun's companies from Thailand, where do they go?
All the above. I mean, there's a demand for all three. And therefore, that feeds into mixed-use developments, which is then you bring a retail component in as well. Because the key to this is one thing that two things are missing in Yangon that really distort the real estate market. One is the lack of mass transit, which is no real big surprise at the moment, because a lot of countries in that lack of developed status don't have mass transit. But it makes it hard to get around. The bus system is terrible. Hopefully improve over time. But one of the other key things that is also missing in Yangon, which people forget, is the lack of motorbikes. You cannot, apart from police, in the Yangon city, you cannot ride a motorbike. It's banned. It's been banned for, I don't know, 20, 15 years, something like that?
Less than that.
But so this distorts the market. So if you go to Bangkok, you get a condo, you can jump on a motorbike and a few minutes you're at your BTS station. In Vietnam, the whole of Vietnam is so fluid. I lived in Ho Chi Minh City, and it's just fluid. If you're late for a meeting or you want to get to the airport, you jump on a motorbike and you'll get there. In Yangon, it's very different, and it's getting worse. It's almost getting worse by the week. The traffic snarls are worse than Bangkok now. And 2 years ago, you could almost have a Grand Prix there. And it's getting far worse, and therefore, you want to be where your office is. You probably want to be fairly close to where you live, and then you want a retail component. And it's nice to have a hotel near the office, so that if you have a nice office, you can have your guests stay at the hotel. So I think that compared to other markets, I think mixed use is also going to be a key factor, because they all feed into one another. The positives of a service apartment feed into the office, and they all feed in, and then the retail kind of is the center of that. And Landmark is one example.
Absolutely. If I can add a little bit on that as well. Tony made a very good point in case, and that location is very important. So you always, when you look at developments, you always look at the location, what is suitable, the feasibility of the location before you really decide what to build on it. Mixed-use developments are obviously a natural choice because each component will complement each other, so that the sum of the parts is actually greater. So it enhances the whole value. However, the problem is that you need a lot of land to build a mixed-use development, right? As opposed to just building a single tower office building or a single tower hotel. You need sizable land to have a podium to fit all these towers in. Yeah? So the difficulty is, of course, getting the right land, which I think many foreign investors, developers going into Myanmar are struggling with right now. That's one of the main obstacles to them being able to move quickly to go into Myanmar to start developing. Right? It's hard to come by, especially in the city center. In the outer areas, yeah, it may be easier, but still, you have to negotiate probably with multiple owners of land to acquire the land before you can develop. In the city center, plots of large scale are very limited, and in any case, may not be under the government control to auction off anyway. So that's the difficulty. If you were to break down the different components, offices, hotel, service apartment, retail, what would be most attractive financially? Actually, rental revenue, surprisingly, is quite similar across those. Apart from retail is a little bit weaker, but office and service apartment, take for example, the rental rate is fairly similar in terms of per square foot. Offices, you're seeing anything from $65 to $90 being the benchmark. Service apartment, you're looking at $3,500 a month for 650 square foot apartment. Works out to be just over $60-$65 per square foot. The revenue is actually fairly similar, but the cost for service apartment, the operating cost is higher, and the capex is higher for service apartment. So right now, actually, office stands out to be higher, more attractive in terms of your yield on capital. Yeah. Of course, there are also a lot more people now looking at building office buildings. I see it as one of the more stable, reliable market sector with the myriads of foreign companies now rushing into Myanmar, setting up offices. Together with the existing companies in Myanmar looking to expand. And we see this all the time. Many of our partners are good companies that we work with, foreign companies. They've expanded three or four times in terms of staff in the past 12 months. We ourselves have hired no less than 60 expatriates in the last 18 months or so. So hiring all these people, we need extra space. Even in our own office building, a small office building in Yangon City, we're running out of space ourselves. We're looking at struggling as to how to fit everyone in. So the demand will keep on rising. I think it's fair to say that supply will gradually catch up as well, but it's not reacting as quickly as one would expect, given the difficulties in starting a project in Myanmar. So for the time being, we're still seeing a scenario where demand will be growing.
Okay, okay, so right now we've sort of laid out the ground that everything's in boom. Okay, so now I'm taking my $20 million and I'm going to rush off to Yangon and I'm going to build something. We've heard that there's some problems with traffic. We've heard that supply of land is hard to get. But what about capital controls or capital ability to bring in money? What about labor, both at the low end and the managerial level? What about the need to, legal structure if there's some disputes? Maybe, Tony, you take on that first.
In terms of legal structure, there is actually a pretty clear legal way of doing this, which is through the Myanmar Investment Commission. And they passed a foreign investment law at the end of last year, and it was implemented early this year. It's still got a few niggles in it, and especially the retail. I think people are not quite sure how to go in at the moment, so it needs a little bit of work. But I think it's pretty clear, and it underpins the investment. If you talk to anyone who was involved in FDI in the 90s, none of them got stung by the government. They said sometimes it's difficult to deal with them. Of course, typical in, I think, most countries in the world. But they said, it was a pretty fair relationship. So I think that if the key is to do due diligence on the landowner, if it's not the government itself, this is the biggest problem. It's not only the cost of the land, it's who is. But the question I always ask when I look at a property or I look at land, the first question I ask is, who's behind it? Who is that person behind the land? Can we do business with that person? And it ranges from, yes, it's a business person, they've got different businesses and they dealt with foreigners and they're traveling abroad and they might be tough negotiators, but you can do business with them. to the other extreme where it's a person who has never met a foreigner, who on certain days you're not allowed to meet them because it's their unlucky day, because they're full of superstition. And then they suddenly say, before I want to meet, I want you to put $10 million in front of me to know you're genuine. So and everything in between. So the key to this is who is the Myanmar, if you're doing a JV, who is your JV partner? And one of the other keys is that you may think you found the right partner, but the way they do business is very different to how we do business internationally. You might meet the owner of the company, and you have a great meeting with him, okay? And you say, right, well let's develop. You should develop an office building. Let's bring in the investor, and it's all wonderful. But they've got 20 other businesses. And he runs every single business, and he even has all the information relating to that business. I'll give you an example. We're dealing with one developer now, and they've got a whole range of business, and they also do fit-out for office. And even the owner is being involved with the fit-out, the pipes and everything. He's doing every single thing. He's micromanaging the whole project, and that's not sustainable as the business grows. It needs to have delegation, which is what Cyrus mentioned about the Yomas. What they're doing is they're delegating down, bringing more expats, having a more of an international style of management. And that's what's very missing in Myanmar at the moment. It will change, but it'll take some time.
So let's ask the same question of you, but for you to answer it from the perspective of foreign investors, because you have a home court advantage. We're plopping down our money in front of you. What is the biggest problem that or complaint you get from people that come in?
Well, they're not so dissimilar to what Tony has mentioned. One is the legal landscape. Of course, depending on the outfits of the investor themselves, what they're looking for, how stringent they are with certain requirements, you can circumvent the issues and navigate the system. In Myanmar, there's already an existing foreign investment law, so the legal framework is in place already. So let's not misunderstand this. In fact, the whole foreign investment law has preceded the reform process. I think it was 1998 was the year that the last foreign investment law was enacted. It's been in place since. Foreigners are allowed to invest in Myanmar. Even in 100% wholly foreign-owned projects, okay? There's certain industries that are restricted, but otherwise, under the law, you're not prohibited. Right? But what becomes prohibitive is other things, such as capital flow. If you have an MIC, Myanmar Investment Committee, approved project, meaning it's an approved, government-approved foreign investment project, legally, you're allowed to bring money in, and you're allowed to bring money out. After paying corporate taxes, you can distribute profit abroad. In the past, and to a large extent, it's still a problem now, is the law says you can take money out. But in practice, how do you do it? In the past, sanctions were in place where any remittance in and out of Myanmar was no-no. Even now, as of today, even after the sanctions has been suspended, if you were sitting in Myanmar wanting to buy something from, let's say, Amazon.com, and you start paying, the screen starts flashing up saying that you're sitting in a prohibited or sanctioned country, we will not allow this transaction. You can't actually make any remittance offshore. Even as of now, when big corporations, US corporations like Coca-Cola, Pepsi are all rushing into Myanmar, we still have this problem where capital is restricted, not by law, but just in practice, the banks cannot make those transactions.
So much worse. In our previous session, we heard that Vietnam has 1 million credit cards. This is way worse than that.
Way worse than that. In Myanmar, maybe 10 credit cards. I don't know. Probably closer to zero. But it's improving. We're seeing that the MasterCard and Visa are now going in, working with the local banks. Some of these banks in Singapore are now setting up relationship with the Myanmar banks to facilitate remittance and so on. Putting money in is always easier than taking money out. But some investors take a more practical approach to see, they understand, if they understand the mechanics of an emerging market, they always understand that these are not not atypical in any emerging markets. These problems will happen. It's a matter of how you can be slightly more creative to circumvent these problems. For example, through series of offshore contracts. So instead of distributing profits in the form of a profit, you can have management fees and so on. I also quite often encourage investors to keep the money in Myanmar and keep on investing, reinvesting it. And that's what we ourselves as a Singapore listed company, we also, when we make a profit in Myanmar, most of the money is just kept in Myanmar, and we reinvest it as well. But of course, for example, for financial institutions, private equity funds going into Myanmar, that's not a very good answer to tell them when you say, oh, how do you take your profit out? Well, you don't, you just leave it in the country. Most of them will back out pretty quickly. The other complaints we hear from foreign investors is also, with the many of these, especially the institutional investors, they come into Myanmar with a very fixed mentality that it's a high-risk country, it's an emerging country, you should get a very, very attractive return to justify the risk of going into a market like this. And they often go and ask for 30% IRR as a minimum hurdle rate. And so they come to us and say, oh, we've got 20 million here or 50 million on the table. Finance the projects. I just want 30% minimum IRR. I want maximum legal protection. I want, you know, if the law doesn't protect me enough, then you got to step in to protect me. I want guaranteed repatriation. I want this amount of yield and the whole list of things that they want. And we go, most of the time it ends up that, well, then I don't really have an investment project for you. Maybe you can find a distressed asset to buy, but I don't really have any. So this is, we were at a point where many of the investors come in expecting very, very rosy returns. But quite frankly, no one can guarantee you an exit. You have to rely on there being a buyer after 5 years to buy out your investment. There's no stock exchange at the moment in Myanmar. The banks are not functioning very well yet. So I cannot tell you exactly how you can exit. I can tell you a whole list of possibilities that you may enable you to exit. So for the most stringent financial institutions, it's always hard to contend with, especially with this legal framework that's at best sort of vague. We do find that there are more investors coming in, already putting in money, and those are more privately controlled companies. So they are more willing to take risks. They are they can understand the mechanics of this regulatory environment, and they're willing to work within that environment.
Maybe I'm not sure if you two are both the people to answer this, but Tony, you certainly can field this area. A lot of Thailand's success was because of tourism, and you know, people coming more than once over time, saying, "Oh, this is a good place. I like it here. I think I feel comfortable. Let's set up a small private business or whatever." So, you know, what are you seeing in terms of, you know, the construction of hotels and the demand for quality management international brands? And then the second thing, maybe Cyrus, you can help me, is what are the industries that are the future? I mean, we'll talk about, you know, we in the previous one, we saw that in Vietnam has the electronics, has the textiles, and then the agriculture. So, yeah. Tourism, why don't you?
Yeah, I mean, I worked in Thailand for some time, so I used to study the market. And one of the key points of tourism is not necessarily the numbers, it's the number of returnees. Thailand has about 65% of tourists are returnees. They've been there once, you know, been there once already. Malaysia is 17%, 17%. And that makes a big difference, because not only does it mean you don't have to spend your time marketing, people know it's word of mouth, but another crucial point is when you have a problem occur, like the red shirts in Thailand or the floods, returnees come back. Returnees know Thailand, they know it back of their hand. They know that you know, this will be over, and actually I'll probably get a cheap hotel a few weeks after the riots, okay? And I know that, because I know people coming back think, oh yeah, the hotel rates are down, I'll come back. So they know it's safe again. Myanmar, one of the key things is I spent a little bit of time in Bagan, which is the main sort of tourist destination with all the temples. And I compared it to Siem Reap, which is in Cambodia. And one of the key things that's beginning to happen in Bagan, when you speak to the hotel owners, is the first lot of tourists who come will spend 2 days in Bagan, 2 days in Yangon, 2 days in Mandalay, in Ney Lake. Then they're coming back to Bagan, right? And they're spending 4 or 5 days, and they are doing, they're not visiting one or two temples, they're getting the vibe, they're getting the bicycle and they're cycling around and they're enjoying the day-to-day life of that town. And they will come back, they will be back every year because they're seeking the lifestyle, they're seeking not just the tourism that you will see in Siem Reap, where you take your pictures of Angkor Wat, etc., and then go back and probably not come back again. And Myanmar has a very strong potential to have returnee tourism that hasn't happened in Malaysia, is very unlikely to happen in Vietnam as well, because of the nature of the country. So I think that there is a connection people have. I've seen this also in Cambodia. They start to have a connection with the people themselves, and I can see that happening in Myanmar. I'm already noticing people have an affinity for the country. So even when disaster happens, in a sense, it creates a greater cohesion with the tourist or the traveler and the country. So I'm bullish at this point about Myanmar being a very strong returnee tourism country in the same vein as Thailand in the future.
And now what are the other industries should we look for as the priorities?
Well, from the government's point of view, one of the key things is first infrastructure building. The country is in dire needs of better infrastructure in power, in road, in transportation, and then it goes down all the way down the list to schooling, to urban planning offices, and so on and so forth. The other thing is manufacturing is going to be a key driver, as we see, for Myanmar. For a few key principal reasons. One is manufacturing will probably be the best sector to provide employment, to provide very widespread employment to the country. Second of all is it can earn very good export dollars. This is the same model that you've seen coming over and over again in all emerging markets in this region. You first go into strengthening the manufacturing sector, and then everything else will quickly follow on that. In fact, the government does put in very close to the top of their priority how to implement this plan. The very first law that the new parliament and the new government put in place after 2010 was the Special Economic Zone Law, which was in many ways modeled on Shenzhen of China, the first special economic zone in China, where they give very attractive tax incentives and other incentives to attract investors to come and invest in manufacturing, and they give tax breaks and duty-free bonded parks and so on. So that will hopefully drive the economic growth of Myanmar. Of course, you also need infrastructure to support that. So power needs to be in place. A lot of the natural gas to Myanmar now is being exported to this country, in fact. And under the current agreements, there's not that much left for the Myanmar government to use. So that's an issue that they need to tackle, provide cheap and reliable power. Right now, I think every day in Myanmar and Yangon now, you get power cuts, albeit for short periods of time, but it happens every day. It's not stable enough. And for a manufacturer, that pushed the price up considerably. Land is something that they need to provide, cheap and easily available land for manufacturing needs to be provided. Right now, a lot of industrial land is being speculated, and land prices are artificially high. That prohibits many of the industrialists coming to Myanmar wanting to invest. You see, from the previous presentation, from the previous panel, about wages in Vietnam. What it didn't show in the chart was that, apart from Vietnam being the lowest in terms of wage in this region, Myanmar is actually probably half the cost of Vietnam. So already we're seeing a lot of Chinese manufacturers, Hong Kong manufacturers, Japanese manufacturers coming to Myanmar looking for opportunities, wanting this to be the next destination for them to put their production base. But the problems that they always face is they don't know whether they can get reliable electricity. Many of the times, the landowners always say, yes, it's okay. We'll provide power. I know you're the government official. We'll be able to provide you stable power. There's no guarantee. Right? There's no guarantee the government can provide that either. Right? There's just purely not enough of that infrastructure. And land is not the problem.
We're running low on time, yeah. So I want to touch on one final topic, particularly for this audience, and have both of you answer this. For investors or people based from Thailand, what's the advantage or disadvantage right now of Myanmar opening up? You mentioned, for example, employment. You know, there's a lot of...
Well, certainly there's a lot of Myanmar nationals already working in Thailand. And all of these people, well, many of these, and we're seeing them, many of these ourselves, are very eager to go back to the home country and to be closer to the family as well as to contribute to the development of the country. So many of the Thai companies will probably have a good network of capable Myanmar staff that can help them to go back to Myanmar. It's always much easier if you have a local to help you navigate all the connections and all the networking in Myanmar. And then, of course, Thailand itself has seen how over the years has evolved and how the regulatory framework has evolved. And that's not so different from what we're seeing in Myanmar. Some of the land rights that are applicable in Myanmar were quite similar to how Thailand was 30 years ago. So compared to someone coming from Europe or America who have never seen a place where people trade on land or apartments without a title. Mm. Right? The Thailand investors would probably be more adaptable to all this. But otherwise, I think you know there's for investors from every country, you're facing exactly the same opportunities as well as the same obstacles.
Yeah. Maybe Tony, I'll give you the last word on that thought.
Well, just as I've taken quite a few Thai people around the manufacturing areas of Yangon, and one of the comments they say is when they see a lot of buffalo, more buffalo than workers in some places, they say, oh, it's just like being in Thailand 35 years ago. Mm-hmm. So I think, yeah, as Cyrus said, there's a little bit more earthiness about the Asian investors. They've kind of got more experiences. And one other key thing, and maybe not respect of Thailand, but Thailand and Singapore, is they've already been investing in Myanmar, and they've been there for some time. A lot of the FDI, a couple of hotels, one office is Thai-owned, a hotel is Thai-owned. So they already have experience. That makes a big difference for the European and American investors. It's a completely new country for them because they never came here apart from the exceptions of an oil and gas company, a few other exceptions, where a lot of Singaporean companies and other Asian countries already have on-the-ground experience. So the re-energizing of the country, the return of the country will be a lot easier for them, and it will be quite a big advantage compared to the Europeans and Americans who, for some, it's completely new territory.
Okay, well, I think I certainly learned a lot. So sitting here, that means that I hope that our audience learned something to take away from this. So Cyrus and Tony, thank you very much, and I'll go back to our hosts.
Thank you very much for a very productive session from the panelists here. Once again, may I ask the panelists to stay on the stage for the photo session. And let me sum up here. For this 2 days conference that we have been participating in Thailand Focus 2013, we can see there are a lot of comprehensive keynotes and panel discussions from the honorable speakers and also the panelists. I believe that all of the participants will get a lot of benefit from Thailand Focus 2013, one way or another. On behalf of the Stock Exchange of Thailand, Patalas Securities Public Company Limited, and Bank of America Merrill Lynch, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to all of you who participate in Thailand Focus this year. Hopefully, next year, we'll have an opportunity to welcome all of you once again in Thailand Focus 2014. Thank you very much and have a good day. Sawadee krap.